I have my agenda here. Good afternoon. Welcome to Thurston County Board of County Commissioners. You know what we call this? Appointed Directors Open Forum. It is 11:10 a.m. My name is Ty Mentor, Chair of the Board. Are we live streamed on this one? Okay. Vice Chair, then we'll just go around and make sure everybody knows who's here. Vice Chair, Commissioner Fournier, Commissioner Mejia, Commissioner Edwards, Commissioner Klaus participating on Zoom. County Manager Leonard Hernandez, Assistant County Manager Robin Campbell. Directors, go down the line and just your department and who you are, so we have it on the record.
Joshua Cummings, Director of Community Planning and Economic Development, otherwise known as CPED. Sorry, Sherry.
Okay, Sherry Elg, Director of IT.
Chris Robert, Acting Director of Central Services.
David Bain, Public Health.
Patrick O'Connor, Public Defense.
Ben Miller Todd, Emergency Services.
Jennifer Walker, the Public Works.
Rob Gelder, Assistant County Manager.
I'm Nate Block, Acting Director of Pretrial Services.
Okay. Thanks everybody for being here. It's great to have a full house. We usually will just go, it's open forum, so I'll just kind of give brief report on what's new and hot topic in your various departments, and I'll just start to my right here with Nate. Okay.
Well, for those of you who don't know me, I'm not Carrie Hannon, the Director of Pretrial Services. I'm sitting in for her while she's on vacation. So if you have questions about pretrial, I will do my best. If you have questions about the hub, I gotcha. So happy to report that the hub is growing rapidly. We onboarded a second FTE in March. We had 197 visitors in March, which is a 30% uptake from our highest number so far. And we saw 497 for quarter one, which is double the year before. So good stuff. On May 17th, we'll be hosting an event, which you should all have gotten invites to come sort of share your ideas with where the hub's going, what we could be doing different. We're also going to be hosting a countywide donation drive. I haven't announced that yet. We're announcing it right now. So you're the representative directors, you should all be getting an email, or at least your aide will get an email asking to appoint someone from your office to act as lead on that. That'll take place pretty soon. Hopefully we'll close that out in June.
Is that for donations to that resource closet that you have?
Correct. Yeah. Yeah. And then as far as pretrial, so the APPR efforts are ongoing and are focusing on data and sustainability. Intensive technical assistance will end at the end of 2024. Pretrial services diversion is currently serving 131 clients. Lots of focus on lots of focus on connecting with other county programs, and they will be working with Public Defense and the PAO in May on another round of training for attorneys to ensure they're familiar with the program and how to refer to it.
And Leonard, if you have questions about any of this stuff, like APPR, I know is probably something you don't know what it is. Feel free to ask, but I see Commissioner Edwards' hand.
I was just gonna, maybe for Leonard's benefit too. Nate, if you had to put a nutshell, the benefit of the hub, the benefit of pretrial services to the taxpayers, to the citizens?
Oh, for pretrial, that would be a really great question for Carrie Hannon.
Well, it saves us jail time. And
sure, it does. This acts as a good conduit to make sure that we are promoting accountability without having to be so heavy-handed about the approach to help keeping people in compliance, especially for, you know, misdemeanor, low felony level charges. The hub sort of acts as a good landing spot for folks who are struggling to get to court appointments, who are in need of connections to resources in the community. Substance use disorder assessments, we're doing those for free right now. Things like that.
Yeah. Keeps people out of the cycle of recidivism.
Actively trying to disrupt recidivism.
Any other questions for Nate? Yeah.
I don't know if, you know, I was wondering, I know that you went through a huge recruitment that was Carrie's last report, and I'm wondering, you know, how has that turned out? Are you fully staffed or?
For the hub or pretrial?
I was just wondering for the full personnel.
So pre-trial, we did have a recruitment for the program manager, and we are going back out for recruitment for that position.
The supervisor just hired, right?
That is the program manager position.
Okay, that position was filled, wasn't it?
It was, and it did not, it's now vacant, so we will be going back out for recruitment.
Oh, okay. I didn't know it was filled, I was wondering. That's good to know.
I had heard it was almost like, I know Carrie had somebody that she was either extended an offer or really excited about, so that didn't work out.
She started.
Someone did start, and it did not end up being a good fit. So they have left employment with the county and will be recruited.
Probably don't want to talk a whole lot about personnel issues on a live meeting.
I apologize. I was just wondering. I was like, oh, weird that, you know, I was like, refilling. Sorry.
Public Works.
Well, I will stick with the employee theme. So Public Works is a 221 person department. Year to date, we have hired 11 new employees. We've promoted 11 current employees, and we've had 12 separations. So just with, we're basically at 50% of internal promotions, which we're excited about because we like to be able to promote from within. Of those 12 separations, 33% of those have been as a result of retirements. Of the remainder, 42% of those that have resigned have gone to other agencies for more money. We currently have 30 vacant positions. 17 are in the process of interviews, and then 6 we have as active job listings. 7 we have on hold for various reasons. We are getting ready to start a very, very busy construction season. The board saw some of the agenda items for next week's spoke about today, and then a few road closures that we've talked about. And with we're getting ready to have our my leadership team retreat, which is on Friday. One of the items that we will be working on is succession planning. Because we have a number of folks that are eligible for retirement, so we're looking at identifying how we can make sure that there's some knowledge transfer, that we can be as prepared as we can be in the public sector for those separations. We have started some of that with desk reference manuals for some key positions. I think we have some more to do there, but that is our focus right now.
Questions for Jennifer? We're excited about the Country Club Green Cove report we got from that today.
Yes, yeah, big project for us, so staff has done a fantastic job managing that.
All right, Ben, EMS.
Perfect. I'm going to kick it off with emergency management. We go from one plan into the next. That's kind of our theme. We go into comprehensive emergency management planning that kicks off next week on the 18th. There's just a quick executive summary that went out as to what that process looks like, but it's about a two-year process as we go through the comprehensive emergency management plan and develop that with a wide variety, 100-plus stakeholders throughout the community for our emergency management plan countywide. Additionally, the executive seminar is planned at the end of May, beginning of June. We're still solidifying the speaker timeline, and so that date will be forthcoming very shortly. As well as we're kicking off the Ready, Set, Go messaging. This is to revamp or re-message what evacuation notices look like. We all get confused, and it's difficult to convey out to the community what a level 1, a level 2, and a level 3 evacuation are. And so there's been rebranding throughout the region in the Ready, Set, Go campaign to message to our constituents when there is a timely evacuation notice what that actually means. Getting ready, getting set, and then actually going in terms of how we'll do that messaging moving forward. And so we're kicking off that campaign to make sure that everybody's speaking the same language in these emergent situations. Lastly, for EM, I wanted to bring up that we do have a blood drive that will be coming up on the 23rd of May. It will be from 10 to 3 at the Tilly campus. We're working on getting one more centrally located, but it falls during National EMS Week, which we thought was fitting. And then coincidentally, the Red Cross was able to support it on quite literally Save a Life Day. And so quite a few things aligned for us to be able to host it on that day. And so we welcome anybody. You'll see the notice go out countywide for registering for a time slot.
You said May 21st?
May 23rd. On the Medic One side, we have started our comprehensive planning components. Our comprehensive plan should be briefed to the board coming up here about the end of June, we anticipate, or early July, that we'll be able to present that comprehensive plan. It is a little bit of a caveat, I'll say, that planning for fire and EMS actually functions independently from the 2045 comprehensive plan that's ongoing currently, and so it sits outside of that planning process. But we try to make it marry or touch that plan as we go forward. So you'll see that it's an independent comprehensive plan just because it isn't wrapped into the 2045 comprehensive planning process. With that being said, our 50th anniversary, just a reminder, is this year. August 4th is the official 50th anniversary for Medic One as we go forward, and we're planning in late September to have a gala supported with stakeholders and community members as we go through that process. I kept it streamlined.
You know where that would be held at? Do you have a location for that?
At this point in time, we're anticipating, and we're in the final contracting phase, so I'm nervous to miss message, but it's looking like it'll be at Indian Summer.
Any questions for Ben?
Ben, how are we doing on Narcan response and overdoses in general with your operation? Do you keep track of that? Is it going up? Is it going down?
Yes.
I'm going to ask David the same thing. So how are we doing in that regard?
So you're going to hear a presentation and conversation this afternoon at the Board of Health. I'll be speaking regarding our deployment method and what our responses look like. Right now, we're still in an upward trajectory, as the rest of the nation is, for responses to those that are experiencing opioid use disorder or overdoses surrounding opioids. And so we're still seeing an upward trajectory in terms of our response, which then coincides with utilization of Narcan in our community. So.
Fentanyl is your main culprit, is it?
At this point in time, yes. That can be variable over time, but currently in the community, and I'll let actually David speak to that component of it, but by and large, we're seeing fentanyl.
So we're getting a preview of what's coming this afternoon, I guess. Huh?
Yeah, that's a very brief preview of the presentation conversation this afternoon at the Board of Health.
I will, on a different note, the blood drive on May 23rd, that's also when we do our rodeo at Tilly, so you might have some built-in, you might have already been planning on that in terms of built-in donors potentially, so that's also National Public Works
Week. Or they drive the vehicles.
Maybe after, but we need to make sure there's enough juice and cookies for.
That's fantastic.
Rodeo is pretty cool if you haven't seen it, new commissioners haven't been out there. Some pretty amazing stuff. Public Defense.
Okay, well, good morning, Commissioners. Patrick O'Connor, Director of Public Defense. Catching up, I was out of the office last week for spring break with my family. Thank you, Robin, with your team, working on a rodent issue over in Building 7 while I was out. Mouse in the house, some mice in the, some whatever rhymes with mice. So my team's working with our guys on that. Yeah, thank you. The big update from us is the changes in public defense and the standards that I briefed the board on. I think we have that scheduled for this Monday as a work session. Rob passed along, received and passed along some of WASAC's recommendation on how to account for implementation and expense. So that's certainly our number one priority. We're working with Sherry's team for our case management system to try to define a very specific search so we can get a very specific estimate as to expense and cost in implementing those. As you're probably aware, I know we last time we talked about this, there was some pending litigation here in Thurston County on behalf of some counties. It was unsuccessful. I'm sure we'll continue to have conversations going forward along with the 38 other counties on how this will be funded. So without getting too in the weeds on that, the weeds will be there on Monday, and I'll try to offer my thoughts and plans forward for how to implement absent budget. Hiring, we're doing well on hiring. We have one vacancy right now. It's an attorney vacancy, and I'm optimistic. We have an internal legal assistant that's been with us who just took the bar, and results come out later this week. So I'm really hoping we'll be able to fill that internally. It's great to promote from within. So I hope she's not watching, no more pressure than she's already under. Our statewide public defender conference is at the end of the month. Again, my appreciation to the board for supporting our training budget a couple years ago and increasing that. We're able to send 25 staff to that statewide conference up in Winthrop. Not only is it a great continuing legal education opportunity for them, it's a great opportunity for them to meet their colleagues around the state and to be candid as an employer. It's a great recruiting opportunity for us as an agency. So I'm excited about that. We have one staff that's presenting at the statewide conference, so really proud of her. I think, Robin, we have a meeting coming up with your team to discuss first quarter financials. So if we'll be able to provide an update after that meeting, one of the upcoming meetings here. And then we're working on a proposal with the ITC subcommittee for an investigative tool for our investigators. It's a system which gives them access to find individuals, find phone numbers, addresses, things like that. So we've submitted that paperwork, and we'll see where it goes from there. Happy to answer any other questions.
This might be a question for board of directors of WASAC, but I'm just curious, like, with that lawsuit being dismissed, the judge didn't say it wasn't a good argument. They just said that the counties didn't have standing.
Correct.
So is there any effort that could be made to come up with, like, I think the judge said there needed to be a class action suit by defendants, and can somebody go out and gather that? Is there any effort in that regard to shift and create the right set of plaintiffs to make the argument that might have validity, and certainly based on that Davidson case, seem like it would be potentially successful? You know,
I think there's a lot of strategies going forward. It's a topic that I serve on the Defender Association Board of Directors, and we are meeting on Thursday of the conference at the end of the month to discuss other strategies to fund public defense. So I should be able to provide an update. It makes sense
I don't know how you go about doing that, but
I think there's some opportunities. I don't want to commit the Defender Association to that, but I believe they would have standing.
Yeah. So, right. Yeah, you need like a public interest organization
there's a lot of ideas that I've seen floated around about next steps, and we can talk more about that. I'm sure there's a lot of conversations that are going around with WASAC and ideas from other counties. I think the need is there to have a bipartisan bill to address this issue. So rather than taking another chance with litigation,
of course.
To me, that seems the best path forward.
Patrick, did you receive the calculator, and are you working on that?
I did. Yes, I did. I saw that last week, and one of the things, as you look at that calculator, is we need to be able to generate the number of cases that fit in with each category, right, to have an accurate total. And I'm not able to do that right now. We're working on this specific search within our case management system that would allow me to do that. Otherwise, I'd have to go back and hand count thousands of cases and put them in the category. I think we're pretty close to having this search complete, so I can get a much more accurate picture of, you know, what it's going to look like.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me and the budget team know if we can assist in any way.
Okay,
because
I appreciate that.
We want to have that number when those statewide listening meetings
sessions are coming up. I think we're pretty close. I'll do another check-in with our team on how close we are to the search. Our provider needs to create the search, and it's not overly complicated. At least that's what they're telling me. I just
Sure.
I would just kind of want it done.
I looked at the spreadsheets, and I mean, that's a basic building block of how we get to how much.
Yeah, it's very useful, and I think we'll be there in the next couple of weeks. I don't think I'm gonna have something by Monday, but I'm trying.
So we should come up with some type of an estimate for us to provide at that meeting.
Okay, yeah.
I will be attending the listening sessions, I'm sure my other students will as well, so.
Yeah, and if there are any other upcoming listening sessions and you need me to attend, I'll make myself available.
Thank you. I had a question to you, and I'm not sure if this is for you or for Sherry, in regards to Axon and how that is coming along.
So we did have a meeting a couple of weeks ago with the sheriff and the prosecuting attorney. Thought it was a really productive meeting. I think we have some ideas on some thoughts and some plans going forward.
We're getting a quote right now.
Yeah, I'll defer to my colleague, but it was a productive meeting. I think we all recognize, you know, as it pertains to GTAC and the sheriff's system, that it's not meeting our needs as a county and the stakeholders that use it. So it was a really good meeting, and I'm happy that we had that conversation.
Chris was there too.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We included everyone.
So I think we have some ideas going forward that I'll let Sherry speak to.
Perfect, so it's been kind of combined now as we move forward. Okay, that was, thank you.
All right, thank you, Public Health.
Yeah, David Bain, Public Health. I don't have exciting updates, which honestly for us is good. That is a good sign. The focus for us as of our last meeting has been on hiring, and I think at this point we're at 19 of our 28 positions being filled, which is really exciting. So literally every week I get a new round of people coming on board, which is I'm sure not fun for Rob signing all those things, but it's been fun for me. I mean, well, Robin, I guess. but it's been good for us. So it's a lot of onboarding, a lot of trainings being set up, a lot of spacing we're trying to figure out, both Lily and at the atrium, but it's a good problem for us to have. So I think the board actually just recently approved us to expand some of our cubes, I think at Lily recently for that purpose, which is great. 2 weeks ago, I was at a national preparedness conference in Cleveland and with my emergency preparedness manager, and had a really great couple of days there and came back with lots of ideas and thoughts about how we can collaborate, particularly with EM and Medic One as a public health entity. I'm excited to sort of see that collaboration move forward. And then, Commissioner, we'll work on, for this afternoon, updated overdose numbers. I don't have them top of my head, but we're happy to get that to you. That's it.
David, when you and I met, I think it's pretty significant that new role you're going to have at Wesolfo.
Yeah, so I will be the president-elect for Wesolfo this June. Thank you. we'll see if I actually.
What's the acronym?
It's
the Washington Association of Local Public Health Officials.
Thank you. I'm excited about that role, both for this. My chance to work with the system statewide, but also to sort of have a Thurston perspective at the state level too, will be great. So
the CIO could do an article on that, maybe.
His PIO could.
What's she saying? Is that what she's saying?
It's like his PIO could
do. Oh, snap.
Questions for David? All right, Bruce.
For recruitment, we've got 3 getting ready to post, 3 posted, 2 a job offer, and 3 starts in the last week. Just an update on, I mentioned that facilities is moving out of 2500 Mottman. They are out, that lease is done, so one less leased building. Inventories for rate development were posted on 4-1 for customer offices and departments to review, with the due date of 4/15. Fleet is in the Axon discussion because can't just go in vehicles. So we looked into that conversation as well. Any questions?
Questions for Central Services. All right, thank you.
Okay, IT, Sherry Elk, IT Director. Our inventories are also due on Monday the 15th, so don't forget to fill those out. They're very important. We filled the tech manager position with an internal candidate. Our network supervisor promoted Chris to that position, so that's a lot of relief for me. And then we hired a temporary project manager, thanks to your approval. And he started the day after you approved it. And he's making a big difference on the ERP project and also on me. So thank you for that. That leaves us with four vacancies in IT, which two of them we're not getting any applications for, any qualified applicants. And the other two we're interviewing and potentially offering soon. They're in the background phase, so.
Which two are you not getting any applications for?
The GIS-3, and we got a lot of applications for the network supervisor, but they're not qualified. So the GIS analyst 3, we're having a lot of trouble filling that one. You may have noticed today there's a flag on your emails in your actual inbox that says these are external emails. We implemented that a couple days ago so that people, when they get an email, they'll know for sure if it's coming from David Bain or somebody else internal. So that was a thing we took to the IT committee and we moved forward with that. We also turned on the complex password requirements as a result of one of our audits.
Yeah, I just went through that.
Yeah.
Annoying.
It wasn't complex enough. Yeah, we talked about that at the IT committee also, and it was agreed that that's a smart thing to do, and that's going to help us mitigate the findings from our last audit that we have wimpy passwords in the county. Not anymore.
So I just did my cybersecurity retraining, and like they were talking about like that the new advice is to string like random words together rather than going with the crazy number of characters and high, you know, like or like and maybe capitalize a random letter here
passphrase,
or there.
Passphrase, yeah.
But it like makes it a lot easier to remember if you do it.
Right.
So I'm gonna see if I can try to
come up with a phrase.
Look at that.
1, 2, 3, 4. Just yeah. Wasn't cutting it.
Not
anymore.
Not gonna work anymore.
Like, hello, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
So that's exciting stuff. That pretty much mitigates the remainder of the things from our last audit, our CISA audit. We have a Secretary of State audit starting again in June, and this is a repeat of the one that was done back in 2019. So. It's more comprehensive. It focuses on different things than that CISA audit did. So get great stuff out of these audits. We're planning an engagement with Microsoft to beef up our major incident response plan. Our current incident response plan does a really good job with smaller, more local types of outages or business disruptions. So we're going to use some of the hours we have with Microsoft to focus on more disruptive, major or widespread to beef up our incident response plan. So that's also very exciting. We have a lot of new requests coming in. Those IT subcommittee review requests. I think we have 6 already for the next IT subcommittee. So things are really heating up. We're getting very busy.
Sorry, Sherry.
That's all right. Sorry. You're not the only one. That's what I have.
What's a major?
So a major incident would be like something that affects, it's widespread. A power outage could be a major incident, but that's their problem. it impacts us, but it's something that's going to take everything down or out, or a major cybersecurity attack or something like that. Bigger than just an outage that can be resolved within the day.
Another thing they said in that training was about password managers and whether or not, and they said ask your, you know, IT team if your organization uses password managers.
They're very expensive, and someday I'll bring it forward to the board and ask if we can have one. But we've utilized one internally to IT, specifically for administrator passwords. And the reason we do that is because we change them, like, daily. So in order to use, to get into an administrative access, you have to use a password manager, but we've talked about it. We just are not sure that's where the priority of the dollars that we have are currently being spent.
Sherry, that GIS3, that's the system and application.
The one you care about.
Administrator, right? So that's that position, and there's only one, so there's no redundancies, there's no crossover. That position is our administrator for our asset management, our computer maintenance management system. So it's an extremely important position. So right now, we cannot make any changes to that software that manages the county's hundreds of millions of dollars of infrastructure. So it's,
they're keeping it up and running, but they can't change it.
Just for connection.
CPED.
So CPED, we have two promotions in the development services group and two new hires. So great to have people moving up within. We also, in our two new hires, one is in the BDC, coming from Harbor Wholesale, hiring for customer service for, you know, making sure that that first point of contact is able to have conversation with people that are buying something they don't want to buy for a price they don't know how much it's going to be for a time they're not sure how long it's going to take. It's a special person to do that job. So we're excited to have that new hire. We also have a former retired law enforcement in our one of our compliance positions working half-time. I think that's going to be a model that I want to move forward is how do you have folks that have been in an experience where they could de-escalate difficult conversations in a way that is still productive and fruitful. And I'm excited to have that new hire in their position as well. So we'll be thinking about doing that programmatically going forward. In community planning, we have a senior planner position open and in process. So looking forward to the successful candidate being announced on that in the next couple of weeks. And the fair manager, we've selected a few of the candidates to move forward in the interview process. So I think that's gonna be good. We've got folks hopefully engaged from the Visitors Convention Bureau, from the Commissioner's Office, and others on the interview panels. So it's a big one. And the Fair Board, obviously. Let's see. HCP, you've heard the updates on Habitat Conservation Program. The permits continue to be successful. You heard a land acquisition request come to you this morning. We had talked about making sure that that process is efficient and streamlined. We're going to have a proposal just to receive input from the assistant county manager later this afternoon, and then to engage with Kidder Matthews, our real estate agent, to ensure that their process in the real estate world and our process in the government world is aligned and as efficient as possible, and dotting the I's and crossing the T's. I would say, again, I think I've said it before, but if you're driving out towards Tenino, the old Alpacas of America Ranch, exciting opportunity that the grazing is now happening on that multi-use land acquisition HCP property. So we're using, we did a competitive bidding process to have folks move their cattle onto the that land that we own, and the cows graze down the weeds. So then the native plants are able to come up when it's their season. So the camas and lupin will bloom more heartily in the late spring because we've been able to graze down the invasive species currently. That is essentially the closing of the loop that we've been trying to accomplish for the past 10 years, and it's just exciting to have it happen as it is right now. So great work to the community planning team. Development Services continues to work through the items in queue. We just had a switchover of the new code from the state in middle of March. So we had a rush of people trying to get their applications vested before that changeover. So we had a big ramp up of more applications come in, but with those new hires, hopefully we can continue to make headway with the folks in queue. Community planning, we've got the comprehensive plan kickoff. It's working really well with the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission has had some great conversations. They're working in a productive and positive manner. Really excited about those next steps. Thank you to IT for their work on Excella. We're still targeting July as the launch and switch over for that. So I know there's a lot of work going on behind the scenes, but appreciate your hard work on that. And I would be remiss if I didn't remind everybody, the fair is Wednesday, July 31st through Sunday, August 4th. And the pancake breakfast is Saturday morning, August 3rd. So make sure you got your aprons and spatulas ready to flip some pancakes for the community.
Doing the
local buckwheat pancakes?
That's a good question for Stephen Bramwell at WCU Extension. I'll ask.
We're good. Try them. My
packet home. They are very good. I finally have.
And that's a great community event that the commissioner's office helps sponsor. You've got all the kids that are staying overnight for the 5 days at 4-H or FFA, and they come up groggy and looking for a good carb load, and we're there to go do it for them and provide orange juice. And so appreciate the leadership from the commissioner's office on that.
Who did the fencing down there for that project on the Tenino Ranch?
That, I'm not
sure. Did we do it? Did some of the folks that are putting cattle on there do it?
We had a three bidding process because it was under a threshold. I'm not sure who the successful winner was, but.
Looks good.
They are, it's agricultural. It's not just fencing, because fencing is a kind of a different, it's fencing in our vernacular, but agricultural pinning is a kind of a different subset. You're going to get me in the weeds on this one.
Oh, I'm not going to.
If you like, I can let you know what a successful contract.
No, it just looks good.
Right on. That's good to hear. And so that's actually something that we're going to need to do for all of the properties that we acquire, because we need to make sure that people aren't running their ATVs on them and not disturbing that area. So that's helpful to hear that that contractor did well.
Other questions for Josh?
Nope. County manager?
I really enjoyed getting to meet the different department heads. Been really impressed with some of their structure and how detailed some of them are. So it's been great. Thank you for all the information you provided, and look forward to connect.
That was a good turnout on Friday for your open house.
Yeah, it was very nice. Thank you, commissioners, for putting that on. Appreciated it.
Commissioners, any reports for directors?
Onward and upward.
Yep. All right. Well, thanks for coming out.
Thank you all for everything you do every day. Yeah. Hey, I'm sure you don't hear that often enough.
We got a heart.
10:47, we're adjourned.
I'm like, are you with that?